Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm Daniele Leone, an assistant professor in management at the Department of Management and Quantitative Studies at the University of Naples Partenope. This is the second time for me to this webinar. If you remember, last year I present another paper on port industry with my colleague Andrea Caporuscio, and this year I have to substitute the leader of this research because this is a working collaboration, Octavio Escobar, that together with Pasqualina Malafronte worked on the part related the systematic literature review. I and Stefania today will present the entire research, especially. We worked on the part related to the background. For example, me worked on the initial part about the digital transformation in healthcare industry, especially regarding the theoretical background. This is a work that is called the topic called the effects of telemedicine on patient well-being. Indeed, our research question is how telemedicines have an impact on patient well-being. I will start with an introduction, with an agenda, just to give you some important details of our research. Indeed, we will start with an introduction in order to fix some important point of our study. The research context, because as Professor Schiavone said before, digital transformation is generating a great amount of data, especially regarding the healthcare industry. I will present the study purpose. Indeed, as I said, our research question is related to the impact of telemedicine on patient well-being. The theoretical background, so I will start to speak about digital transformation in healthcare industry. After that, we reported some important studies about telemedicine that covered a lot of aspects regarding the patient-centered business model that is related to also digital business model because today companies have to create innovative solution to meet patient necessities, to meet patient needs, to reduce time in the hospital. So after that, finally, I will present the research design because we analyzed a great amount of paper that after the selection was 64 papers. After that, Stefania will introduce the methodology and the data collection, the findings of our study, especially regarding some comments about the figures of our systematic literature review, because we used the bibliometrics method. The discussion, some implication of our study, especially regarding the policymaker, the implication for policymaker, because you have to imagine that telemedicines meet some issues related to the patient privacy, especially regarding the protection of patient data. And so I think that this could be a good starting point for future research regarding this topic, regarding issues related to the policymakers and the conclusion and some implication of our study. I can start with the introduction. Indeed, if you take a look of our paper, we will start with this text. So digital technologies are revolutionizing the healthcare industry. Why? Because you imagine that today we have a lot of data to manage, and so companies have to renovate also the operations, and in healthcare industry is In same way, there are a lot of there are groups of stakeholders that differently manage the resources and also the innovation processes. And these managers have to face with different groups of stakeholders regarding, for example, patient association, regions, but also obviously pharmaceutical companies that participate to this decision-making process. Each involved actors cannot create value and achieve a sustainable competitive advantage without new technology-based device. Imagine that today in the hospital, especially with an industrial convergence processes, there is the use of, for example, wearable health technologies that continue monitoring the data of the patients, also regarding the chronic diseases, the different chronic diseases of the robotic surgery, for example, regarding different patients. Telemedicine has become an increasingly popular option for long-distance virtual medical care and education. As I said before, this remote diagnosis is part of our topic because is the main part of our topic because today telemedicine has become a good starting point to start the digital transformation of this industry. We have seen in this research that patients answered positively because they want to be monitored in a constant time from their kitchens, for example. They want to download a lot of data about their care. And the purpose of the healthcare organization, on the other end, is to reduce the costs of remote monitoring of the patients, both before and after intervention, because you imagine that also companies, especially regarding the general healthcare organization, want to gather a lot of data about the patients, also to reduce time and consequently the cost of hospital admission, and also increasing the speed and the provision of telemedicine services. Just to say another thing, imagine that physicians, doctors have to improve their method, their skill with the use of telemedicine, especially regarding with the use of new technology-based device like wearable health technologies that continue to monitor chronic diseases, for example, using artificial intelligence solution or Internet of Things solution. On the other end, we have seen that the use of telemedicines is not only a resource for patients with chronic diseases, but also a core element for the well-being of all kinds of patients, because imagine that the population is aging rapidly, and in this way, the people want to live in a secure way, and the use of technologies helps this type of management of resources. Regarding the issues, we can rename the issues related to the protection of patient data privacy, because this could be a crucial part of the service jointly self-management, because patients want to use telemedicines, but patients want to be sure that their data are managed in a better way, and also in a secure way with security and data privacy. ICT solution and device transform how health organizations offer their services and co-create value with customer or in this case patients. And this type of reason could be related to the patient-centered business models, because with a value co-creation perspective, both health organization and patient can create a good environment to exchange data in a better way. Regarding our theoretical background, we have seen that recent studies attest that telehealth platform required technical skilled experts to support users for their utilization. And also healthcare organizations in this way are evolving to explore the power of telemedicine. And this is the reason that we, together with Octavio, Stefania, and Pasqualina, decides to explore this field of telemedicine in healthcare industry. And our research questions start from this point. So how telemedicine could have an impact on patient well-being? In this direction, the rising paradigm of e-health offers critical future growth opportunities. And imagine that this new paradigm of e-health is related to the electronic medical records that today are used in hospital. The old medical records is a substitute to this new electronic medical record that helps to gather information and data of the patients in order to create a unique database to speed the innovation processes of the hospital, but also the care for patients. And this study is very interesting, of Yesenbach in 2001, about e-health, that attests that e-health is an emerging field in intersection of medical informatics, public health, and business. Because you have to imagine that, yes, we speak about healthcare industry, but also related to the policy maker that are working day by day to improve public health processes. Finally, our theoretical background is related to the disruptive innovation in healthcare, because this is an important way to face several industry problems and also create value, as I said before. And we have seen that telemedicines refer to this remote diagnosis and treatment of patients by means of the telecommunication technology. Another recall to the management of the health system and also the centrality of the patient necessities, because as I said before, telemedicine processes are related to find a good solution for patient needs. In this direction, as you see on these slides on the final part, telemedicine could be the best solution to act on various critical points, such as the setting of specific parameters to combine health, medicine, and technologies. Because today we live in a world that is completely changing, especially regarding, as I said before, the industrial convergence. And so today we talk about med tech industry. And so different group of stakeholders have to work on this way. So to improve and to increase the expertise on the management of technologies, of new technologies to improve this type of healthcare processes. My final slides for this introduction, this overview of our paper, is related to the to the research design. This paper has the aim to provide a systematic literature review, and after this my introduction, Stefania specified these aspects about literature review, and we performed an analysis of 64 documents with the aim to systematically analyze the effect of telemedicine on patient well-being. And just to have an important preliminary indication of our results, we find that our results demonstrate that telemedicine has evolved through different research steps that began with telemedicine not just as a communication medium to complement traditional services, to a technology of automation and decision tool that expand the scope and the range of health services. So this starting point could be an help for the presentation of the main details of our paper. And now Stefania continue this presentation in order to specify the aspects, the analytical aspects of our paper. And I hope that this overview could be a good starting point for you to understand this part of our paper. So I leave the floor to Stefania. Thank you very much for the invitation. And so after the final presentation, I'm here for any kind of question and comments related to the presentation. Thank you very much.
Okay, I try to share my video. Okay. I'm Stefania Melen, together with Daniele and Pasqualiano Front and Octavio Escobar. I was one of the author, and now I will show the results of our presentation. First of all, I speak about methodology. Methodology we used is a bibliometrics analysis. We know that bibliometrics is a method, is a way to give quantitative aspects also to literature review. Last decades, it is a very popular method, and in specific, we used a bibliometrics software. There are a lot of software that give us the possibility to perform this bibliometric analysis. We try to use, we start to use this software was, that was developed in Federico II together with the Partenope University house, so it's a sort of in-house software, and is interesting because it is also an open access software, so give us the possibility to develop a sort of community of scholars that use this software to analyze literature. The database this software use is Scopus, Web of Science, PubMed, Digital Science Dimension, and Cochrane. So we can choose a lot of database, and we decided to use Web of Science. And our step of the methodology we used was, first of all, the extraction of articles from this database. Then we selected the articles because we also have a qualitative study because we try to compare titles, abstract, and keywords also to our topic, to be sure that these articles were in line with our exigencies. And after we had the analysis to identify some clusters, factorial analysis, with highly influential articles, and then also the qualitative part of the analysis studying each cluster. In the figure I will show, it will be more easy to understand what we studied. So to have the possibility to understand our literature review was really important to center topics. And we use patient-centered with the different declination, patient-centricity, patient-centered. And telemedicine or telehealth or e-health. And this was really important to design, to choose these keywords, because of course it's a semantic choice to understand how to be in topic. And as a time span, we started from 2000 until 2012, and after we will see why. Of course, telemedicine is a new concept. Some little example of telemedicine were also present in literature some decades ago, but really important literary production started during last years. And of course, we have to refine the categories about journals we choose. And of course, as for our kind of studies, we choose the economics, business, and management. So journals that are part of these categories. As a language, we choose English. And citation indices are SHI expanded, the SSCI, A and HCI, CPCI and S, and so on. This is quite technical. The first step gave us the opportunity to have 90 articles, but after we refined to have 64 articles, because some articles were not proper in topics or were more linked to medical problems. Then we started our bibliometric analysis with cluster and influential papers, and then we had the document analysis. So our results focused on some aspects that for us were more important. Bibliometrics give a lot of figures, a lot of graphs that could be interesting. We choose to understand what kind of annual scientific production regarded our topics, which journals and scientists have more influencing impact on the others. What are the conceptual structures of field? So the first figure we choose is figure one, annual scientific production. This is interesting because we can see that some articles were just published in 2000, but were one or two after some years. So there was not an important production. Was just in 2007 There was an article by Lansen and Andreasen that studied electronic care on people readiness and attitude toward performing self-diagnosis. So first article were on specific aspect as self-diagnosis or some specific application of telehealth. This interest in telemedicine was really growing. So we have some peak until a sort of explosion of literary production. And of course, is important to say that this was before the explosion of pandemic problems, and is really important to see also what will be the evolution of this production after the use, the massive use of telehealth during pandemic problems. This is a sort of figure in which we can see that among 46 sources, we analyzed the most influenced articles, and there is a sort of concentration of more influencing articles, but one 198 authors was involved in this kind of studies, in this kind of research. So we can see that is really an interest in a lot of cases, in a really important influence articles published in TFSH. And in this figure, also we can see the trend topic of the world. This kind of software bibliometrics give us the possibility to have an important analysis of the trend topic of the words used from a semantic point of view, so we can understand all the studies that link together telehealth, well-being, and patient centricity. And some keywords are really present in all these articles, in all these works. So it's really interesting to understand how, for instance, care, quindi then the e-care, the electronic care, is linked to telehealth, and how a sort of new model of a new ecosystem of telehealth care is coming. And this other figure is about the thematic map. In this figure, we can see that the size of bubbles represents the frequency of keywords used, and of course, innovation and impact are motor teams. That means that are a sort of transversal teams that impact on all other aspect. So considering density and centrality, other clusters are about design, model and care, quality and health, and performance, network and healthy behavior. And all these things are really important in all the analysis and are a way to build a sort of a new way of analyze medicine and the impact on patients. Probably the aspect that we can analyze better is about clustering. In fact, this bibliometric analysis give us the opportunity to understand how the model, the business model, we can say, the healthcare model is evolving in literature. So cluster one is about acceptance and adoption of telemedicine. Telemedicine had a lot of, we can say, funds, but also a lot of physicians that were septic, or a lot of patients that were septic at the very beginning, and also some scholars have some problems to accept this new way of give medicine a possibility to enter the life of patients. The second cluster is about data management in telemedicine. That is also really an important aspect as for privacy and as for big data we can speak about. And the third cluster is about communication and design of telemedicine. And about the discussion, we can start from this analysis. First of all, we identified two kinds of communication. One is communication between the system, the telemedicine system and patients. And another one is about communication from from professionals to patients using telemedicine. These two kinds of communication is really important as a new organizational model, new management models. And we can say that there are a lot of virtual communities that derive from this use of telemedicine. Another aspect really interesting is about the use of new big data that we can derive from the use of telemedicine and the massive use of telemedicine. And all this data are part of a new possibility of application. And as Daniele said before, we have to see how to use this data to have the possibility to give more health to and more well-being to patients and avoiding to give problems to their privacy. And of course, is important challenge to understand how healthcare, internet, and all electronic application, all devices could be part of our life, especially for everyday life. So if at the beginning telemedicine was used for chronic patients, little by little now is an answer to all problems that also everyday life of particular troubles could have as an answer. And of course, the pandemic was also an acceleration of this problem. So it could be really interesting to understand what will be the evolution of the telemedicine after COVID. So I was really happy to be part of this conference today, if you have questions together with Daniele, we could answer to your curiosity, your question.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you,
Daniele and Stefania. I lost the
I read some questions.
Some
the
of
chat.
The questions, yes, I lost.
Okay, I have to read the chat.
Yes, okay.
Daniele, could you give examples of the devices and ICT solutions used in hospitals and that are included in telemedicine?
Yes. For example, the brassiere that girls used, and the brassiere used by doctors to monitor constantly the heart rate. This could be an example. Another example could be the watch. For example, last week I read an article about the key watch for the glucose monitoring, especially basically on remote diagnosis, especially using this type of technologies. Yes, this could be two examples, but there are a lot of examples of new technologies used by doctors at distance to monitor the data and information of the patients. Yes, this could be two different examples, the key watch to monitor the glucose and the brassiere used by girls to monitor heart rate.
Okay, yes. Then, yeah, first I would like to invite all the students to ask questions. There are a lot of students from the master link of RNI, and I see only questions. Don't know, there is one from a student, but otherwise there are from usual suspects. So there is one from the student of at ULCO, and he said, what are the weaknesses of these telehealth platforms, these systems? Could you raise?
If Stefania is agree, I can answer to this,
yes, Daniele,
to this question. Okay, I think that two could be the weakness of this system. The first one, if you remember, I said during the presentation regarding the protection of patient data privacy, because when we use this type of telehealth platforms, patients want to be assured that their data are used in a secure way. The second one, I think that could be related to the market access of new technologies. Together with Professor Schiavone, we are working, but we have also published articles on the topic of market access related to the drugs, but this is a new phenomenon also related to the access to the market of the, for example, wearable health technologies, but also regarding in general the medical devices. Today, this type of medical device follow not an easy way to go to the market, and this new phenomenon of market access that is an innovation, especially regarding the management of the system, have the aim to reduce the time to market for medical device. At the moment, this could be related to a weakness of this system, but in future use this type of managerial innovation, management innovation, the time to market for this medical device could speed up, and it could speed up also the process for patient, for the delivery of a good healthcare for patients. I don't know if I have answered to your question. If not, please, if you can repeat your doubts, I'm here.
Then there is another question from a student, with Jaime Otaigi. Sorry if I pronounce this like very badly. As we are talking about sensitive data, do you think that telemedicine will be able to keep patient data secure in an effective way? And will it be able to withstand possible malicious attacks? Also, do you think governments will let third parties handle such data? So it's about the sensitiveness of the data, which flows through the telemedicine.
I read another time. You are referring to the comments of Jaime Otaigi?
Yeah, Jaime Otaigi.
Okay, because we jump some questions. Okay.
Yeah, we jump because I mean there are the
yeah for sure no
first
okay.
The question of the students.
Yeah, it's similar. I imagine yes. do you think that telemedicines will be able to keep patient data secure in an effective way and will be able to withstand possible malicious attack? Also, do you think governments will let third parties handle such data?
So it's about really data transmission and who is about the security of data.
Yes,
we'll handle.
Good question. My opinion is that government, because for example, if you remember during my presentation, I anticipated that our paper could be a good starting point for the government to develop new policy issues related to this type of problems. Regarding malicious attack, yes, could be happened. I think that government, yes, will let third parties handle such data, but depends from the information that patients put on these telehealth platforms. I don't know if Stefania have other idea regarding this question.
I think that we have, of course, implement cybersecurity. We also had some problems about vaccinated people some months ago in Italy. The Ministry of Health website was hacked, but in any case, it's really, really important to have the possibility to study all this big data. For instance, all diabetics that use remote devices to understand their glucose eater could be also a way to understand better diabetes as all day long. The possibility to have to monitor 24 hours a day some disease is a really an important way also to change the cure, the medicine about this disease. So I think that of course we have to be very careful with the cyber attack, but at the same time, it's really important to use this data.
Okay, then Sophie Boutillier has a question about the use of telemedicine and the reduction of health expenditures. So do you think that telemedicine is a good solution to reduce health expenditures? or to improve on the other side health conditions for the population in the future. And I guess that she was talking about elderly population. In society, elderly people, especially in society where elderly people are more and more numerous. So it's about the expenditure, the reduction of expenditure and the improvement of health conditions.
Okay, thanks for this question. I think that telemedicine is a good solution to reduce health expenditures, but especially because if you imagine that a patient can be monitored from home, from their bed, and not from the bed of a hospital. So hospital reduce costs in this way. Hospital reduce also times to manage patient information in access to the hospital. I think that could be a good solution also to improve health condition of the population. Because if you remember, I say during the first part of our presentation that patients today want to understand day by day their data, their healthcare data. And so probably the health condition could be improved in the future if, for example, if patients use the telehealth platforms to monitor day by day their chronic diseases, for example, like diabetes, I think, for example. Regarding, I think that I have answered to this question. Now I read also another question related artificial intelligence. Intelligence from Dimitri. Isn't artificial intelligence dangerous for data protection? How do others generally deal with this issue? I think that artificial intelligence solution is dangerous for data protection, absolutely. But today, I think we have to understand if artificial intelligence is a solution that could avoid not only the mechanical and analytical aspects, but the aspects related to the emotions. If artificial intelligence could be a good starting point to analyze the empathetic aspects of the people, here probably there is a dangerous for people, because I think that the amount of data regarding this type of aspects, not only mechanical and analytical, because today companies produce algorithms to monitor this type of diseases, but if we enter in the empathetic aspects, it's dangerous. I don't know if Stefania won't add something.
Of course, I think that could be a really important solution, artificial intelligence. And I think that also for social expenditures, the more we learn from artificial intelligence and automatic system, the more we could have less expenditure trying to see new patterns from a medical point of view. So I think that is not only a way to effort new way of manage disease, but also a way for organizational part of sanitary system, because we know that hospitals have a very important aspect from an organizational point of view that could be changed with the new system. So not only the medical aspect, but also the organizational managerial one is really important. Also with the system of artificial intelligence.
Okay, then there is a question of Blondine. Is about how telemedicine, could you develop how telemedicine increase well-being of patients? Is it the case for all type of patients, young, old ones, whatever the kind of disease? So.
I think, okay, thanks for this question. Yes, depends from the case of, depends from the type of patients, because imagine that older people have a well-being aim could pose different from younger people. In this case, older people have to improve their skills about the use of telehealth platforms. But in this way, imagine that older people can be monitored at distance using remote diagnosis of the doctor for their diseases, especially regarding not very, very difficult diseases. For example, I don't know, diabetes at the first stage, you have not to go to the hospital, but you can be monitored at distance. I don't know, Stefania, you want to be, because this could be also part of the analytical.
Yes, of course, we think about smart watches. There are a lot of smart watches now that could monitor important health aspect, for instance, about heart, and of course also these watches could give patients the opportunity to understand if they have also little problems about blood pressure, about the frequency and of heart bites. And of course, this is a way to avoid to go to very complicated disease. So I think that it's really important to understand what kind of improvement of our life, our daily life are given by this kind of aspects. This kind of devices.
It's still time to ask questions. I have one, if I can. Would be about the geography of telemedicine and publications. I mean, in which country is telemedicine most advanced and developed and diffused among patients is there a relationship between the authorship, the countries, yeah, the authorship or the countries of origin of the authors? So is there a link between the diffusion of telemedicine and I would say the scientific questioning of this aspect?
I don't know if Stefania remember that we faced with these aspects in our research respect to the country of origin. If I remember, not.
Not because was not an important aspect, because was quite the same production in all developed countries. Of course, it could be an important way of healthcare also in not developed country, but we know that telemedicine have a cost, the same production in all the developed countries, so USA, Australia, Europe, and China, Japan, have the same production. So we didn't care about this aspect, but because it was not different, it was not something.
But thanks for this question, because this could be a future research that we can develop in this way. Because imagine that also, for example, in Italy, I can report the situation in Italy, for example, with a thesis of a master's students, we have seen that, for example, in northern Italy, electronic medical records are used better than southern Italy. So depends also, this could be a good starting point for future research, because yes, depends also from the knowledge about this type of topic regarding the telehealth platforms in general. I have also to add, and I think, because now I remember that we forgot to thank the guest editors for the opportunity to publish this paper in this special issue, and also the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Innovation Economics and Management. So thank you very much for the opportunity to publish this this paper. And so just this thing, because I remember that I forgot to say this thing at the beginning of my presentation.
It's done. Blondine. What about the resistance to the use of this kind of technology, especially from older patients? Is this an issue, or?
Can you repeat? I
the resistance to use. I mean, what about what about the resistance to use of this kind of technology, especially from older patients? I mean, is there, from the user side, a big resistance to use telemedicine?
The resistance to use, yes. Okay, this, I think that in this way, probably older people have this type of problem to use telehealth platform, because they resist to use older method of care, I think. And regarding telehealth platforms, there could be the help of, for example, young people to help older people to use this type of telehealth platforms. So the resistance to use is high, especially for older people, less for young people. I think that this is the situation at the moment. Regarding our paper, I think that we have analyzed this type of aspects, but it is not the main topic of our research.
Are there other questions? I know that there are students from the university, the National University of Vietnam. Do they have any questions? And welcome to the very remote. So it's not telemedicine, it is. So To Nguyen, do you want to ask a question? No.
Mr. To Thieu Nguyen, do you have any question for the, or you want to say anything to introduce the research team?
I cannot hear you, sorry.
Oh, these are not students, it's a research team from Vietnam. You don't hear us? Can you hear us?
Now, yes.
No.
That's right.
You want to introduce?
Yes, Mr. To Thieu Nguyen, can you introduce our research team in Vietnam?
Okay, so thanks, Sun.
Hi.
Could you hear me?
Now, yes.
Okay, so I'm very happy for join this seminar. So, and I think it's this rest academic space for us and a good network, I think. So we hope to share interesting research between two faculty, two school. And I think psycho economic and innovation and well-being as interesting research for us in Vietnam. So I would like to present some news in the our faculty. So our faculty is a multidisciplinary training with about 4,000 students per year. And our school offers three level, bachelor, master and PhD degree. And so we look forward to having an exciting cooperation in the future. And now we have some small project on well-being and on psychoeconomic and innovation. I hope in the future we can connect, we can make some paper together between two faculty. So we also is open with you. Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much for this proposal, because we are interested in cooperation. And if you are happy, I'm also happy. And you can write also an email to detail this type of cooperation, because we are happy to join a new collaboration with other universities. I think that's yes, I can report my email on the chat, because probably I and Stefania at the end of our presentation.
Okay.
Can you see this type of text, Daniele.leone?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. So thanks for this for this proposal. So I'm happy to start this type of collaboration. Mm. Write an email and we can organize a Skype call.
Okay. So very good. Very good. Very happy.
Yeah. Okay.
Enjoy it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Nice to meet you. Okay, so nice to meet you.
Yeah, I think next time we can in Vietnam we can present some interesting paper for you. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Good.
Thank you. Are there other questions to Stefania and Daniele, or Giuseppe more broadly? Or are there persons who participated to the special issue who want to ask or complete or make a comment on? No, I guess we are at the end of...
In fact, I had something to ask.
Okay.
Another comment about the resistance of patients to use technologies, because we worked on the subject of older people and how they react to technologies, to new technologies, and we found that it's quite difficult for them. Of course, there is resistance for some many type of devices. But companies try to reduce this resistance by the way of implying these patients in the process of developing the technology. So it's a co-innovation, it's a part of open innovation strategies, innovating with patients and implying them in the process of developing new technologies. And I think it's a quite interesting issue about the possibility of diffusion of this kind of e-health technologies and so on. just a comment.
Like. Yeah, yeah, no. Thanks, Blandine, for these insights, because open innovation business model is related to the telemedicine, because patients have to be involved in the innovation processes of companies, especially regarding healthcare organization. But you have also find that older people have to be involved in this type of process, or in general different from younger or older people. Also older people have involved in this type of innovation processes.
It was a study on older people. We did not compare with the youngest ones.
Younger to older, okay.
But it was quite something quite new that companies try to involve this kind of patient.
Yes.
Usually it's more young ones or association of people who are diseased or people who have health problems, etc. But they try to involve also aged people in order to help them also understand exactly the way they behave and the problems they face, so that to develop innovation that can
in this way
can be adapted to them,
especially because in this way patients can anticipate the process to use this type of, for example, of telehealth platform or artificial intelligence solution before this solution enter in the market. So this could be thanks for this insight. Mm-hmm. Any other question?
Comments? No, but it's almost 3:30. So, last chance.
But we respect the deadline of our webinar.
You were perfect in timing.
Yeah, indeed. Perfect in time. Less five minutes, but... yes, we are in time.
No, but you were also in time in terms of presentation. Was really like perfect.
Okay.
Just perhaps we could also just ask to the University of Lorraine to open the camera if possible, because I know they are in a big room with many students listening to us. So one name, but many students, and perhaps it's not. Easy to ask a question, but anyway, you can still do it, or you can be in touch with the author.
Just show them.
We have a black.
There are no questions, I think. Sorry, we have no video.
Okay, well, but we can imagine.
There are hidden students.
Hidden students. But in fact, it is in the context of the program Innovation Master Link, into which several master courses can join the Research Network on Innovation and take part to the different webinars and also to the conference. So, congratulations for being there today, and for all the colleagues who also are responsible of masters, please, you can join us also and join this program, Innovation Masterlink. If you need some more information, do not hesitate to contact us.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think it's time to thank everybody, and especially the presenters of the special issue and the paper, and also to thank you for the very good discussion we had after the presentations. And so we meet again in the same, almost same configuration next month. I guess it was the 9th of November. I've closed all my...
it's the 12th.
Oh, the 12th of November.
Just let me check, but I think it's the ninth.
I think it's the ninth, but
it's a nine. Ninth.
Yeah, you know, my memory is not that bad. It was.